Joining us now in Hot Copy, we have with us political scientist Clive Arguelles. Good morning, Clive. Thanks for joining us on a holiday.
Good morning. Thank you for having me again.
All right, Clive, WR Numero just released a survey with regard to the presidential candidate preferences of voters for the 2028 national elections. It showed that 36% of 1,500 respondents will vote for Sara Duterte as president in 2028 if the elections were held in December 2023. Now, of this figure, it's interesting to note that 44.2% identify themselves as administration supporters. So my question, how will the recent tirades of her father and her younger brother actually affect those numbers, considering that they were directly, a direct assault against President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.?
Right. Thank you. I think with the recent developments in the relationship between the Marcos and the 30 families, I think we're likely to really catch the development on that in the next round of the survey. But at least for this particular survey in December 2023, this was already the time that there were public campaigns against the vice president. I would say that some of her rivals also participated. This is something to do with the request for confidential and intelligence funds of the office of the vice president. There were also, very public hearings about her office during that time. And I think what one of the things that we can learn from these numbers is that she did win with a higher number in the 2022 vice presidential elections. And now, although she's the top choice for many Filipinos, that number is not the same anymore, right? So I would say also that that may be, we could interpret in a way that may be the result of such campaigns, right? That now half of her original supporters are actually considering other potential candidates that they could support in the possibly 2028 presidential elections. And we see that the second choice for many Filipinos in that survey is Senator Rafi Tulfo. So that may be the effect here. Rather than sticking with the vice president or with the Duterte family, their voters might look for other candidates to support.
All right. Vice President Sara Duterte, as you mentioned, faced several controversies late last year, confidential funds, her performance as DepEd secretary, and yet she still garnered about a third of the votes in that survey. What do you think still drives the vice president's popularity at this point in time?
Yeah, I think she has an advantage over the other potential candidates, right? I think it's built in the position that she's currently occupying. She's an incumbent vice president. So although she's facing these controversies, she also has a national constituency compared to the other rumored potential candidates. Filipinos, generally, according to our electoral history, they do not necessarily punish their vice presidents, or meaning they do not necessarily withdraw their popular support to the vice president, as long as the vice president is seen as a very cooperative and participating in the administration. So actually, this will be very interesting if this trend will continue, because now that there's a world war between the Marcos and the Duterte families, it will be very interesting to see in the next few months whether Filipino voters would start to think that the vice president is no longer cooperative with the administration. And from what we know about past survey data, once that is perceived by Filipino voters, usually they do withdraw their support to the vice president. And we've also asked a couple of questions about her performance. So it's showing that around 73% of the surveyed Filipinos actually think that she did good, if not very good, performance as the vice president, at least around the time in December 2023, and that they actually also find the state of education has improved under the Marcos administration, of which the department she's leading, that's around 57% of Filipinos saying that the state of education has actually improved compared to the previous Duterte administration, her father's administration. So despite these controversies, it appears for now that the vice president still enjoys that relative popularity among voters.
And with the recent developments in the Philippines' political landscape, how likely is it for the president and the vice president to actually endorse different slates in the 2025 midterm elections? Do you still expect a uniteam senatorial version happening next year?
Yeah, I think Kat, at this point, we should just be expecting that there will be two different administration tickets. I think it will be hard to imagine how they can come up with a single administration ticket. Because this infighting between the Marcos Duterte, the Uniteam Alliance, we have been observing some signs, right, for the past year that there is a rift among the different factions inside, right? And the recent developments would actually tell us that this rift is not going anywhere, right? It's here to stay. And in fact, we're seeing, that the level of intensity of this infighting among them is actually increasing. And part of, I think, what's driving really the wedge between these different factions has something to do with 2025. Because despite the administration enjoying majority, if not more than majority numbers, in both houses of Congress right now, and the Malacanang and the vice presidency is also theirs, right? The coalition is big, but in 2025, they'd have to figure out how to run a ticket that will satisfy everyone. But because Uniteam is quite, it's too big right now in terms of the size, they will be forced to choose, right? Some factions, members of the Uniteam over others. And I think this is really also what's driving the conflict currently within the Uniteam Alliance.
All right, since you already mentioned the 2025 senatorial elections, WR Numero also conducted a survey with regard to that race. Number one on that survey is Axis Representative Erwin Tulfo with 59.7%, followed by former President Rodrigo Duterte with 54%. Now, the bulk of those survey respondents who supported Duterte in that survey identified themselves as administration supporters, about 56%, I think. So do you expect a drop in the former president's survey numbers, considering the things that he spewed against President Marcos Jr.?
Right. This may be one of the outcomes that may happen in terms of how people would be voting in the 2025 midterm election. So, for example, one of the interesting findings of our survey related to what you just discussed, Kat, is that when it comes to the 2028 presidential elections, among opposition voters, the top choice is actually Senator Rafi Tulfo. And then in a close second is the former Vice President Lenny Robredo. I think it's not surprising that among opposition voters that the former Vice President Lenny Robredo would rank high, right? But it's quite surprising to also see their responses, and that one of the top choices is also Senator Rafi Tulfo. And I think I've been asked about this, and I think what's also happening is that some of those voters who we asked are starting to identify themselves as opposition voters, not necessarily because they are opposed to the Marcos Duterte administration, as you would expect from the self-identification, right? But I think because it's possible that they are opposition, they're opposing the Marcos administration, but still supportive of the Duterte administration. So I think this kind of permutation is likely to happen as this infighting between the Marcos Duterte Alliance continues. And it will be interesting to see and map how that would affect the support for the former president Rodrigo Duterte, whether those who are those who are still happy with the Marcos administration would still continue to give their support there to him come 2025, or whether they will abandon him. But for now, given the numbers that we are seeing, because in the past survey data, we know the base number for the Marcos supporters, the base number for the Duterte supporters, and that's around 25 to 30% each for each camp, respectively. So if you're polling high, and you know we see that former President Duterte is polling more than 30% for as a possible 2025 Senate race, that means that the likely interpretation there is that the Marcos supporters are still with him, at least during December 2023.
All right. And interesting to note also that with recent developments, former President Rodi Duterte is seemingly positioning himself as an opposition candidate should he decide to run in the 2025 midterm elections, while his daughter, interestingly, still remains with the administration as the president's education secretary. What do you make out of that political play?
Yeah, I mean, as a political observer, I think this is one of the defects of our political system, right? That personalities can just jump from one side of the political spectrum to the other, and it can confuse voters, right? And it doesn't help strengthen governance, because the idea between having an administration and opposition is that the opposition should perform certain responsibilities in ensuring that the administration will fulfill its governance duties, right? But right now, what we're seeing is that this kind of like division is happening on the basis of their opposition to each other, and that's not how it's supposed to. That's not how it's supposed to work, right? And I think the vice president for now, Sara Duterte, is also stuck with in the Uniteam Alliance. We all see publicly the developing story here, so it may be just a case that the former president and you know her brothers, Mayor Baste, Representative Pulong, it may be the case that they're just the advance party towards going to that direction, and the vice president may eventually join them as soon as as soon as she can take that hit in terms of the popularity. As I've said, when it comes to past data, what we see is that if the vice president leaves the president and is perceived to be uncooperative, people usually withdraw their support to that vice president. So she may just be testing the waters, looking for more time, and eventually may join her father as well. So that's also a possible scenario here.
Right. Too early for the vice president, for the second in command, to actually break away from the president himself, given that she may become a lame duck vice president once she severs those ties with President Marcos. But isn't this also a way of actually capturing the entire spectrum, in a sense wherein you have one member of the Duterte family still clinging with the administration and the other positioning himself or themselves as part of the opposition?
That could be the gameplay here. We must be reminded that these are dynastic politicians, and we cannot underestimate the strategies of dynastic politicians. You know, we've had dynasties that have been in power for like more than a century, right? And their staying power something to do with their political intelligence and how they game the electoral system. So if that's the scenario for the Duterte, that they just want to catch all of the potential votes, right? You know, it's a catch-all kind of like strategy. Then I think that would also be plausible, given that we also observed that in Senator Amy Marcos, for example, who we know is also quite close to Vice President Sara Duterte. So she's doing the same thing, except for the other side, right? For the other family, she's attempting to also catch the anti-Marcos but pro-Duterte kind of like constituency, but at the same time still sticking with the Marcos constituency. So that may be the gameplay here.
Right, both sides playing the same game. But let's talk about another Marcos relative who is perceived to be the vice president's rival. House Speaker Ferdinand Martin Romualdez placing quite low in WR Numero survey, only gaining 1% when it comes to the 2028 presidential race survey. To what do you actually attribute his low survey numbers?
Yeah, I think the House Speaker is at a disadvantage here, right? Despite occupying a really powerful, influential national leadership position, he hasn't really won the support of the people to be able to get there, right? Because the House Speaker is elected internally by the members of the House. So he got there first by being voted by his own district constituency, right? Which is a far smaller number than, for example, the number of people who voted for the vice president, the incumbent vice president, but also even for the senators, right? And then he was able to convince the members of the House that he deserves the speakership post, right? And that's a different game altogether than convincing the rest of the Filipino people. There are many different considerations in that. And what this December 2023 survey is showing is that if the House Speaker is really intending to run in 2028 for the presidency, then lots of catching up to do, right? He has to really introduce himself to the public. He has to communicate what he stands for the public. And right now, we are seeing that kind of like attempts, if I may say, right? We see a very public House Speaker, but I'm not sure exactly if the kinds of issues are the things that he wants to be associated with, right? Definitely the House is associated now with the really messy and really messy People's Initiative, right? The House is also being very public about its criticisms against senators, also against the vice president, right? And I'm not sure if that's strategic, right? Because they're going against senators, vice president. These people got to their positions by convincing the Filipino people at a national scale that they deserve these positions, right? So they have national constituencies. They're quite popular on the national scale, right? So that may also be contributing to the low numbers of the House Speaker that is going against this, if you will, national giants, and without being properly introduced to the public, and you know the public isn't responding so well to that.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of the People's Initiative, some lawmakers, members of the House in particular, have been distancing themselves from the PI. What do you make out of that? Can the PI still bear fruit considering the number of lawmakers who are seemingly distancing themselves from it?
Yeah, I think what's clear here is that without the Senate, the Senate is really the graveyard of any of these charter change initiatives, including this recent People's Initiative, because without their without enthusiasm on their part, right, then it doesn't really matter. And now that they're also even if the People's Initiative is technically something that could because one of the provisions that's being proposed here is to override kind of like the Senate, right, to a joint voting in the Congress, in both houses of Congress, right? And even if that happens, even if that's the proposal, right, you see now that the Senate is not really just standing back and letting it happen, right? They're also using their parliamentary powers to make sure that they're part of this conversation and that they wouldn't be marginalized and sidelined. So I think one of the biggest roadblocks here is really has something to do with whether the Senate will cooperate or whether they will continue this unified stand. And it's quite rare actually for us to see 24 senators with different political persuasions coming from different political parties. Some of them are actually rivals as well, right? Standing on a similar issue. And this is so it's quite a strong position that the Senate is taking, and that's one of the considerations here. Also, I think that despite the attempts of the people in the House, right, our representatives to make it popular and to defend the People's Initiative, for example, we see even the President Bongbong Marcos is also not really publicly embracing, not really publicly declaring his support for the People's Initiative. And that's a sign, that's a big sign of, even if Malacañang is really playing waiting game here and checking if this will end up something that will be popular for the people, but they know that currently that's not really the case, and that's not really necessarily the situation on the ground, right? So yeah, so I think the People's Initiative, which is now proven to be there were government funds spent, right? It's quite a messy process, and it's not really genuinely coming from a grassroots attempt to propose new provisions or amend provisions in our constitution. Yeah, I think I would say that the prospects are not really as good as when they started when it comes to the success of the PI.
All right. And unfortunately, that's all the time we have for this morning. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, and we hope to see you soon and hear from you soon again, political scientist Cleve Arguelles.
Thank you, and have a happy Chinese New Year.
Gong Yi Fa Choy.